This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Norman invasion of Ireland took place in stages during the late 12th century, at a time when Gaelic Ireland was made up of several kingdoms, with a high king claiming lordship over all. In May 1169, Cambro-Norman mercenaries landed in Ireland at the request of Diarmait MacMurchada Dermot MacMurragh, the ousted King of Leinster, who had sought their help in regaining his kingdom. This military intervention had the backing of King Henry II of England. Pope Adrian IV had authorized Henry to conquer Ireland as a means of bringing the Irish Church into line. Diarmait and the Normans seized Leinster within weeks and launched raids into neighbouring kingdoms in the summer of 1170. There were two further Norman landings, led by Richard Strongbow, de Clare by May 1171. Strongbow had assumed control of Leinster and seized the Norse-Irish city kingdoms of Dublin, Waterford, and Wexford that summer. High King Rory ua Conchobair Rory O'Connor led an Irish counteroffensive against the Normans, but they managed to hold most of their conquered territory in October 1171. King Henry landed a large Anglo-Norman army in Ireland to establish control over both the Cambro-Normans and the Irish. The Norman lords handed their conquered territory to Henry. He let Strongbow hold Leinster in fief and declared the cities to be crown land. Many Irish kings also submitted to him, likely in the hope that he would curb Norman expansion. Henry, however, granted the unconquered kingdom of Meath to Hugh de Lacy. After Henry's departure in 1172, Norman expansion and Irish counteroffensives continued. The 1175 Treaty of Windsor acknowledged Henry as overlord of the conquered territory and Rory as overlord of the rest of Ireland, with Rory also swearing fealty to Henry. However, the treaty soon fell apart. The Anglo-Norman lords continued to invade Irish kingdoms and they in turn launched counter-attacks in 1177. Henry adopted a new policy. He declared his son John to be Lord of Ireland, i.e. of the whole country, and authorized the Norman lords to conquer more land. The territory they held became the Lordship of Ireland and formed part of the Angevin Empire. The largely successful nature of the invasion has been attributed to a number of factors. These include the Normans' alleged military superiority and program of castle building, the lack of a unified opposition from the Irish, and the Church's support for Henry's intervention. The Norman invasion was a watershed in the history of Ireland, marking the beginning of more than 700 years of direct English and, later, British involvement in Ireland. Contents 1. Background 2. Landings of 1169. 3. Strongbow's invasion of 1170. 31. Irish counteroffensive of 1171. 4. Henry's invasion of 1171. 5. After Henry's departure. 51. The Treaty of Windsor and Council of Oxford. 6. Terminology. 7. See also. 8. References. 9. Bibliography. Background. In the 12th century, Gaelic Ireland was made up of several over kingdoms, which each comprised several lesser kingdoms. At the top was the High King, who received tribute from the other kings but did not rule Ireland as a unified state. The five port towns of Dublin, Wexford, Waterford, Cork, and Limerick were inhabited by the Norse-Irish and had their own rulers. The Normans had conquered England beginning in 1066. Over the following decades, Norman lords conquered much of South Wales and established their own semi-independent lordships there. According to historian John Gillingham, after the Norman conquest, a new imperialist attitude emerged among England's elite, and they came to view their Celtic neighbours as inferior and barbarous. In September 1155, King Henry II of England held a council at Winchester. According to Robert of Torigny, Henry discussed plans to invade Ireland and grant it to his brother William. However, the plans were put on hold, allegedly due to opposition from his mother, the Empress Matilda. Wikisource has original text related to this article. Laudabiliter. Some of the initiative for invasion may have come from Anglo-Norman church leaders, especially Theobald, Archbishop of Canterbury, who wanted to control the Irish Church that same year. Pope Adrian IV, the only English pope, issued the papal bull Laudabiliter, which authorized Henry to conquer Ireland as a means of bringing the Irish Church into line and enforcing the Gregorian reforms upon it. Irish Church leaders had legislated for reform, notably at the Synods of Cashel 1101, Rathbresale 1111 and Kells 1152. However, implementing the reforms was slow and difficult. It would demand the abandonment of features of Gaelic society going back to pre-Christian times and of practices which had been accepted for centuries by the Church in Ireland. These included attitudes towards marriage, clerical celibacy, the sacramental system, and control of church lands. John of Salisbury, secretary to the Archbishop of Canterbury, spoke in Rome about the barbaric and impious people of Ireland in 1149. Influential French abbot Bernard of Clairvaux had written a book about St. Malachy, in which he described Ireland as barbaric and semi-pagan. According to historian F.X. Martin, Ireland was barbaric in Bernard's eyes simply because it had retained its own culture and had remained outside the Latin secular world. John and Bernard's depiction of Ireland, rather than the truth about its reforms, became established throughout Europe. Landings of 1169, Henry authorizes Dermot to levy forces, from a Chronicle of England 1864 by James Doyle in 1166, Dermot MacMurchada Dermot MacMurragh was ousted as King of Leinster by a coalition led by the High King, Rory Ua Conchobair Rory O'Connor, and the King of Breffni, Tigernan Ua Rourke Tiernan O'Rourke. However, he was allowed to remain chief of his home territory. Ui Sinsalag High Kinsella Dermot fled Ireland and sought help from Henry II in regaining the kingship of Leinster. Henry gave Dermot permission to recruit mercenaries and authorized his subjects to help Dermot in return. Dermot was required to swear loyalty to Henry. Several marcher lords agreed to help: Richard de Clare, also known as Strongbow, Robert Fitzstephen, Maurice Fitzgerald, and Maurice de Prendergast. Dermot promised Strongbow his daughter Aife in marriage and the kingship of Leinster. Upon Dermot's death, he promised Robert and Maurice the town of Wexford and two neighbouring cantreds under Irish law. Dermot had no right to do this, having secured their help. He returned to Ui Sinsalag in 1167 and awaited the arrival of the mercenaries on 1 May 1169. Robert Fitzstephen and Maurice de Prendergast landed at Banno Bay, on the south coast of Leinster, with a force of at least 40 knights, 60 men at arms, and 360 archers. This force merged with about 500 men led by Dermot. They set about conquering Leinster and the territories Dermot had claimed sovereignty over. First, they besieged the Norse-Irish seaport of Wexford, which surrendered after 2 days. They then raided and plundered the territories of North Leinster, which had refused to submit to Dermot. They also raided the neighbouring kingdom of Ossory, defeating the forces of King Donnchad Mac Gilla Patraic Donag Mac Gilla Patraic in the Battle of Achadar. However, Donnchad withdrew his forces to safety and remained defiant in response. High King Rory led an army into Leinster to confront Dermot and the Normans. The army included contingents from Connacht, Breffni, Meath, and Dublin, each led by their respective kings. An agreement was reached at Ferns. Dermot was acknowledged as King of Leinster, in return for acknowledging Rory as his overlord and agreeing to send his foreign allies away permanently to ensure compliance. Dermot agreed to give Rory hostages, one of whom was his son. However, Dermot apparently sought to use his Anglo-Norman allies to make himself high King. Shortly after the Ferns agreement, Maurice Fitzgerald landed at Wexford with at least 10 knights, 30 mounted archers and 100 foot archers. In a show of strength, Maurice and Dermot marched an army north and laid waste to the hinterland of Dublin. Strongbow's invasion of 1170, a map showing the locations of Banno, Beginbin, Wexford and Waterford by 1170. Strongbow appears to have been funded financially for his invasion by a Jewish merchant by the name of Joss of Gloucester. Joss, Jew of Gloucester, owes 100 shillings for an amateur for the monies which he lent to those who against the king's prohibition went over to Ireland. In May of that year, Raymond Fitzgerald landed at Banno Bay with at least 10 knights and 70 archers. This was the advance guard for Strongbow's army and was to be the springboard for an assault on Waterford. Raymond's force occupied an old promontory fort at Beginbin and plundered the surrounding countryside. They were then besieged by a much larger force of Irish and Norse. The outnumbered Anglo-Normans drove a large herd of cattle into the opposing army in the ensuing havoc. The Normans routed the besiegers, killing up to 500 and capturing 70. These captives were then executed. The Normans broke their limbs before beheading them and throwing their bodies off the cliff on 23 August. Strongbow landed at Passage with at least 200 knights and 1,000 soldiers. They met with Raymond's force and assaulted Waterford. The walls were eventually breached and there followed fierce fighting in the streets, in which 700 defenders were killed. Dermot and the other Norman commanders arrived in Waterford and their Strongbow married Dermot's daughter, Aife. The Normans and Dermot held a council of war at Waterford and agreed to take Dublin. High King Rory deployed a large army near Dublin to intercept them, as well as soldiers from Connacht. It included troops from Breffni led by King Tigernan, Meath led by King Mael Sechlain, and Oriel led by King Murchada Ua Serbail. The Normans and Dermot bypassed them by travelling over the Wicklow Mountains, forcing Rory's army to abandon their plans. When they reached Dublin, Dermot began negotiations with its king, Ascal Mac Ragnall Ascal Macranall, on 21 September. While talks were ongoing, a force of Normans, led by Miles de Cogan and Raymond Fitzgerald, stormed the town and took it. Ascal and his followers fled in their ships but vowed to retake the town. Strongbow and Dermot then launched a devastating campaign through Meath and into Breffni, burning Clonard, Kells, and several other monastic towns. In response to these violations, violations of the Ferns Agreement, Rory executed three hostages, including Dermait's son. Irish counteroffensive of 1171. Dermait returned to Ferns and died there suddenly in May 1171. Strongbow thus declared himself King of Leinster. However, he had no right to do this under Gaelic law, and he was opposed by Dermait's brother Murchada. Shortly after Dermait's death, the Anglo-Normans faced a general rising, both from within Leinster and from outside. The Irish of Desmond launched a devastating attack on Norman-held Waterford at about the same time. A Norse Gaelic army, in a fleet of at least 60 ships, landed outside Dublin led by Escal. They tried to retake the town, but were repulsed by de Cogan's forces. Escal was captured and publicly executed. A great army, led by Rory, surrounded Dublin. It comprised troops from most of the Irish kingdoms, contingents from Connacht, Breffni led by King Tigernan, Meath led by King Máel Sechlainn, Thomond led by King Domnall Ua Brian, Oriel led by King Murchad Ua Serbail, Ulster led by King Magnus Mac Dwinslibe, and Leinster led by Murchad Mac Murchada. A Norse Gaelic fleet of 30 ships, sent by Godred Olafsson, blockaded Dublin Bay. Robert Fitzstephen sent his best troops out of Wexford to help the Anglo-Norman garrison in Dublin. The remaining garrison in Wexford was then attacked and forced out of the town. The Normans fled to a military encampment at nearby Carrick, where they were besieged. The siege of Dublin went on for 2 months. There were several skirmishes, but the Irish were apparently content to starve out the Normans with Dublin and Carrick under siege. Strongbow and his council agreed to negotiate. Strongbow proposed that if the Anglo-Normans be allowed to keep what they had conquered, they would acknowledge Rory as their overlord. Rory responded that he would only allow the Normans to keep Dublin, Wexford, and Waterford. This was unacceptable to Strongbow. A Norman sortie slipped out of Dublin and made a surprise attack on Rory's camp at Castleknock. The Normans killed hundreds of soldiers, many of whom were resting or bathing, and seized supplies. Following this defeat, the Irish army withdrew. In the meantime, Fitzstephen had surrendered to the Norse-Irish at Carrick. When they learned that Strongbow was on his way, they burnt Wexford and withdrew to a nearby island with Fitzstephen as a hostage. Henry's invasion of 1171. Henry at Waterford, from a Chronicle of England 1864 by James Doyle. By September 1171, King Henry had decided to lead a military expedition to Ireland. He wanted to establish his control over both the Norman warlords and the Irish. Henry apparently feared that Strongbow would set up an independent kingdom in Ireland, but Strongbow's actions were merely a catalyst for Henry's invasion. Historian Peter Crooks writes that, no less than his predecessors, Henry II was happy to add Ireland to his empire. Henry, as William of Newburgh put it, wanted to have the glory of such a famous conquest and its proceeds for himself. On 17 October 1171, King Henry landed at Waterford with a large army of at least 500 mounted knights and 4,000 men-at-arms and archers. Several siege towers were also shipped over. This was the first time a King of England had set foot on Irish soil, and marked the beginning of English and later British rule in Ireland. The Norman warlords affirmed their loyalty to Henry and handed over the territory they had conquered to him. He let Strongbow hold Leinster in fief and declared Dublin, Wexford and Waterford to be crown land. 15 Irish kings and chiefs submitted to Henry, likely in the hope that he would curb unprovoked Norman expansion into their territories. Those who did not submit included Rory the High King and King of Connacht and the Kings of Meath and the Northern Uí Néill. Henry granted Meath to Hugh de Lacy, meaning that Henry would let de Lacy hold it if he could conquer it in early 1172. Henry allowed de Lacy to take royal troops into Meath, where they plundered and burned the monastic towns of Fore and Killy. Henry also made Dublin available for the freemen of Bristol to colonise. Many of the Norse-Irish inhabitants were forced to resettle outside the walls, at what became Oxmantown. Wikisource has original text related to this article. Privilege of Pope Alexander III to Henry II. The Irish church hierarchy also submitted to Henry, believing his intervention would bring greater political stability. Henry used the church as a vehicle of conquest. He organized the Synod of Cashel, at which Irish church practices were brought into line with those of England, and new monastic communities and military orders such as the Templars were introduced into Ireland. Pope Adrian's successor, Pope Alexander III, then ratified the Laudabiliter and gave Henry dominion over the barbarous nation of Ireland to ensure that its church be brought into line and the Irish would pay their tax to Rome. Henry left Ireland on 17 April 1172, setting sail from Wexford. Some English writers, such as William of Canterbury and Ralph Niger, condemned Henry's military intervention, describing it as an unlawful hostile invasion and conquest. A poem in the Welsh Black Book of Carmarthen describes Henry crossing the Salt Sea to invade the peaceful homesteads of Ireland, causing war and confusion. Gerald de Barry felt obliged to refute what he called the vociferous complaints that the kings of England hold Ireland unlawfully. After Henry's departure, a depiction of Raymond Fitzgerald from Gerald de Barry's Expugnatio Hibernica. Shortly after Henry left Ireland, Hugh de Lacy invaded Meath and was confronted by Tigernan Ua Rourke. The two leaders met on the Hill of Ward for negotiations. During these negotiations, there was a dispute, and de Lacy's men killed Ua Rourke. His head was then impaled over the gate of Dublin Castle. Strongbow also invaded and plundered awfully, but failed to subdue it in early 1173. Many of the Anglo-Norman leaders left Ireland to fight for King Henry in the revolt of 1173-74. When Raymond Fitzgerald returned later that year, he led a successful plundering raid into the Kingdom of the Deici, by both land and sea. However, as their king had submitted to Henry, the kingdom should have been exempt from attack. The Norman raid on the monastic town of Lismore was interrupted by a Norse-Irish fleet from Cork after a naval engagement. The Normans withdrew to Waterford. Fitzgerald then returned to Wales. Due to the death of his father in late 1173, Dermot MacMurchada's son, Donal Comhain Panic Donal Cavanagh, attacked Strongbow's forces in Leinster, killing 200 soldiers around the same time. An Irish army from Thomond and Connacht, led by Domnall Ua Brian Donal O'Brien, forced the Normans out of Kilkenny and destroyed Strongbow's Mott and Bailey Castle. There Strongbow responded in early 1174 by marching an army into Thomond and advancing towards Limerick at Thurles. Domnall Ua Brian's forces defeated a contingent of Strongbow's army, killing hundreds and forcing him to abandon the march to Limerick. Norman power in Ireland seemed to be disintegrating, and in the words of Gerald de Barry, the entire population of Ireland took the opportunity of this disorder to rise with one consent against the English. Shortly after the Norman defeat at Thurles, the Norse-Irish of Waterford rose up and killed the Norman garrison of 200 soldiers. Rory gathered an army that included contingents from Connacht, Meath, Breffni, Oriel, Ulster, and the northern Uí Nail, along with their kings. It marched into Meath, destroying the castles at Trim and Duleek, before advancing on Dublin. Raymond Fitzgerald landed at Wexford with at least 30 knights, 100 mounted soldiers and 300 archers when this army arrived at Dublin and reinforced the garrison there. Rory's army withdrew in 1175, the Anglo-Normans rebuilt their castles in Meath and raided or laid waste the province from Athlone in the west to Drogheda in the east. They also hanged the Irish king of Meath, Magnus Ua Maile Sechlain Manus Omelic. The Treaty of Windsor and Council of Oxford. Wikisource has original text related to this article. Treaty of Windsor on 6 October 1175, Henry II of England and High King Rory agreed to the Treaty of Windsor. The treaty divided Ireland into two spheres of influence. Henry was acknowledged as overlord of the Norman-held territory, and Rory was acknowledged as overlord of the rest of Ireland. Rory also swore fealty to Henry and agreed to pay him a yearly tribute in cow hides, which Rory could levy from throughout his kingdom. A Connacht based analyst reported the treaty in triumphal terms. Cadla Ua Dubtheag came out of England from the son of the Empress, having with him the peace of Ireland, and the kingship thereof, both foreigner and Gael, to Rory Ua Conchobair. However, the Windsor Treaty soon fell apart. Henry was unable or unwilling to rein in the Anglo-Norman lords, and Rory was unable to control all of the Irish kings. Contemporary English historian William of Newburgh wrote that the military commanders left there by him for the government of this subjugated province, desirous either of booty or fame, by degrees extended the boundaries allotted to them. In April 1176, a large Anglo-Norman army from Dublin marched north into what is now County Armagh. This was part of Oriel, a kingdom meant to be free from encroachment under the treaty. However, the Irish of Oriel forced the Anglo-Normans to retreat and killed up to 500 of their soldiers that summer. The forces of Oriel and the northern Uí Nail under Senel Neogain Kinnell Owen invaded Meath, led by King Maile Sechlain Mac Lochlain. They destroyed the castle at Slane and forced the Anglo-Normans to abandon Galtrum, Kells, and Derry. Patrick Strongbow died in May 1176, and Henry appointed William Fitzaldelm as his new representative in Ireland. He was replaced the following year by Hugh de Lacy in February 1177. John de Courcy left Dublin with a force of about 22 knights and 500 soldiers. De Courcy marched north at speed, into Kingdom of Ulaid, and captured the town of Downpatrick the Ulaid, led by King Rory Mac Dwinslibh. Rory MacDunlevy tried to retake the town but were repelled after a fierce battle. King Henry held a council at Oxford in May 1177, which marked a change of policy towards Ireland, he declared his son John, aged 10, to be Lord of Ireland, and made plans for him to become King of all Ireland when he came of age. The territory held by the Anglo-Normans thus became known as the Lordship of Ireland and formed part of the Angevin Empire. Henry also encouraged the Anglo-Norman lords to conquer more territory. He granted the Kingdom of Thomond to Philip de Braos and granted Desmond to Robert Fitzstephen and Miles de Cogan. Over the following months, the Anglo-Normans invaded the kingdoms of Desmond, Thomond, and Connacht, while John de Courcy continued his conquest of East Ulster. Terminology in contemporary or near contemporary sources, the invaders are overwhelmingly described as English. For example, Expugnatio Hibernica almost always describes them as English, so too does the Song of Dermot and the Earl, a source which uses the term English about 80 times, whilst using French, Flemings, and Normans in only one particular line. Despite the modern employment of terms such as Normans, Anglo-Normans, itself an 18th century construct, and Cambro-Normans, contemporary sources virtually never use Norman in an Irish context. Irish sources usually describe the men as foreigners and grey foreigners, or else as Saxon, Saxons, or English. In consequence, it is apparent that contemporaries regarded the incomers as English, despite the fact that they weren't exactly as such in the 19th century. However, during a period of intense and sensitive political debate, the term was dropped by historians and replaced with ahistorical terms. Even amongst modern historians, there is still a reluctance to use English. See also the Song of Dermot and the Earl. Tudor conquest of Ireland, plantation of Ulster, Irish War of Independence. References: Carrick Campbell, Kenneth L. 2013. Ireland's History, Prehistory to the Present. A. Carrot ABCD. Carpenter, David. 2003. The Struggle for Mastery, Britain 1066-1284. Oxford University Press, pp. Carrot ABC. Martin, 2008, p. 71. Carrot Curtis, Edmund. 2013. A History of Ireland, From the Earliest Times to 1922. Routledge, p. Carrot Martin, 2008, p. 87. Carrot Martin, 2008, p. 88. Carrot A. B. Duffy, Sean. 2007. Henry II and England's Insular Neighbors. In Christopher Harper, Bill Henry II, New Interpretations. Boydell Press, p. Carrot A. B. C. D. Martin, 2008, p. 103. Carrot Kildare, History and Society. Geography Publications, 2006, p. 144. Carrot A. B. C. Martin, 2008, p. 104. Carrot A. B. Perros, Helen. 1995, Crossing the Shannon Frontier, Connacht and the Anglo-Normans. In T. B. Barry Colony. Carrot Bartlett, 2010, p. 34, Flanagan. 2005, pp. 17-18, Gillingham. 2000, pp. 151-153. Carrot Gillingham. 2000, pp. 151-154. Carrot A. B. Bartlett, 2010, p. 34, Flanagan. 2005, pp. 17-18, Gillingham. 2000, pp. 151-155, 152-36. Carrot Bartlett, 2010, p. 34, Gillingham. 2000, pvx. Carrot Bartlett, 2010, p. 34, Flanagan. 2005, pp. 17-18, Gillingham. 2000, pp. 152-153. Carrot Flanagan. 2005, pp. 17-18, Gillingham. 2000, pp. 152-153. Carrot Bartlett, 2010, p. 34, Gillingham. 2000, p. 153. Carrot Gillingham. 2000, pp. 153-45, 157-158, 157-62. Bibliography. Martin, Francis Xavier. 2008, Chapter 2, Diarmait Mac Murchada and the Coming of the Anglo-Normans. In Art Cosgrove, A New History of Ireland, Volume 2, Medieval Ireland 1169-1534. Oxford University Press. Martin, Francis Xavier. 2008, Chapter 4, Overlord Becomes Feudal Lord, 1172-85. In Art Cosgrove, A New History of Ireland, Volume 2, Medieval Ireland 1169-1534. Oxford University Press. Timeline. Prehistory, Protohistory, Early History. Gaelic Ireland. Norman Invasion, Bruce Campaign, Black Death, Tudor Conquest, Desmond Rebellion, Spanish Armada, Tyrone's Rebellion, Flight of the Earls, Plantation of Ulster, 1641 Rebellion. Second Great Famine Land War Fenian Rising Dublin Lockout Home Rule Crisis Easter Rising War of Independence Anglo-Irish Treaty Civil War The Emergency IRA Northern Campaign IRA Border Campaign The Troubles Peace Process Economy of the Republic of Ireland Celtic Tiger Post 2008 Irish Economic Downturn Post 2008 Irish Banking Crisis Other topics List of conflicts in Ireland List of Irish tribes List of High Kings Gaelic clothing and fashion List of World Heritage Sites in the Republic of Ireland List of national parks of the Republic of Ireland Ideologies Nationalism Republicanism Ulster Loyalism Unionism Republic of Ireland Constitution Economy Education Foreign Relations Government Local Eructas Parliament Dáil Éireann Lower House Senedd Éireann Upper House President Northern Ireland Assembly Dahont Method Economy Education Government Local Peace Process. Goody Skirts and Kidneys Soda Bread Stew Ulster Fry Drinks Coffee Cream Guinness Mist Poyton Whiskey Dance Jig Sean Nose Set Dancing Stepdance Festivals. Imbolc St. Patrick's Day Bealtaine the 12th Lunasa Rose of Tralee Sawin. Theatre Triads Music Ballads Sa'ili Folk Music Session Instruments Rock Music Traditional Singing Mythology Cycles Fenian Mythological Ulster Aoc Ectrium Rama. Tuatha De Danann Legendary Creatures People Anglo-Irish Gaels Gaelic Ireland Hiberno-Normans Irish Diaspora List of Irish People Travellers Ulster Scots Sport Association Football Camogie Gaelic Football Gaelic Handball Hurling Martial Arts Road Bowling Rounders Rugby Union Symbols Bridget's Cross Clareseach County Coats of Arms Flags N Ireland Flags Issue Irish Wolfhound National Coat of Arms Red Hand Shamrock Other Calendar Homelessness Names Place Names in Ireland Prostitution Republic